Today, we are wrapping up our Salt Life sermon series with a message titled Salty After Setback. It's time that we worship together, so I hope you all have a terrific Sunday, and I'll see you next week.
desert road. Water for my thirsty soul, I need you. Oh, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound.
My story. This is my story. This is my song. Preaching my Savior. Song where I invite you, Community Bible Church, to praise my Savior. Come on, give him some praise. All the
Father, we come today just giving you honor and giving you thanks just for how great and how wonderful and how mighty you are. We thank you for your forgiveness and your mercy and your grace that you have poured out on us. And because of that, Father, no matter what our story used to be, we are not defined by what our story used to be. We are defined as your sons and your daughters, Father. Father, we are so grateful for that. Even though we don't deserve it, you do it anyway, Father. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name.
Every time I walk out of the house, put on another face just to blend in with the crowd so nobody sees me. You would never believe me. I tell you that I'm whole, but I'm still healing. I tell you that I'm happy, but I'm grieving. Thought I was a fighter, but I'm still in the fire. But if I'm being honest, I'm not being honest. And I'll give you roses, just hoping you don't see the weeds in my garden. And if I'm being honest, I'm at my darkest. I'm sitting here praying and waiting for someone to show me. Just being honest. I'm just being honest.
What's up? Good morning, everybody. Good morning, church. How many of you are happy to be here today? Are you happy to be here? Awesome, awesome, awesome. Good deal. Good deal. Come on in. Grab a seat. So great to see you go around welcoming friends, family. Yes, indeed, family. People around you are family, part of the body of Christ, and so it's wonderful for us to meet and welcome, get to know somebody if you don't know them already before you leave here today. Guys, grab your Bibles, your notes, your pens. We're going to get rolling here. And the last message today in our series that we call it Salt Life, Salt Life. How many of you have been here for all three messages in this series? Great. Thank you, guys. Thank you for doing that. And if you have, then we kind of know that we've been tracking Jesus along the beaches and along fish. How many of you like the beach? You like the beach? How many of you like to fish? All right, well, that means you're in the right place today. As we wrap this series up, we're going to see that again. Salt life. Today we're talking about salty after setbacks in life. Let's be honest. How many of you have had some setbacks in your life? Huh? Yeah, probably every single one of us. Well, that's what we're talking about here this morning. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much that you are a God that is faithful, even when we ourselves are not faithful. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness and your kindness, your gentleness, your grace, your mercy that you pour out on us continuously. Father, we thank you for your love, that you love us today so very much, more than we can begin to fathom, to know, to understand. Father, I just pray that will sink in here to us today, that message that you have for us, that even despite our failures and our setbacks in life, that you still, in your mercy and your grace, you have a plan for us. Father, we thank you for that news, which is such good news to us here this morning. Father, we ask that your Spirit would speak and we would listen and we would let it sink deep into our hearts and transform how we think each and every day. Thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey guys, I want to start out in a kind of a weird sort of way this morning with maybe a little bit of a quiz. Anybody up for a quiz today? Are you? Okay, all right. I think you guys are smart. You guys are smart. You're quick. I know. I think you'll get this, okay? Here's what we're going to do. I'm gonna make a sound, and as soon as you hear the sound and you recognize where that sound would come from, I want you to yell out the answer, okay? Let me start out. Here's an easy one. You ready? You ready? All right. Just checking. Moo. Good job. Give yourself a pat on the back for that. That was smart. All right, here's the second one. You ready? Quack, quack, quack. Duck. Yeah, okay. You guys are two for two. Nice. All right. Is it too easy? No? Okay. All right. How about this? Gobble, 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 gobble. See, that was a little tougher. You were slower on that. You were much slower on that one. All right. Here we go. Probably toughest one yet. Cock-a-doodle-doo. Rooster. Yeah. Somebody said chicken up there. Rooster. Good job. Well, that's it. Because you hear cock-a-doodle-doo and instantly your mind goes to rooster. That's what you think of. But what if every morning when you woke up, you heard cock-a-doodle-doo, your mind went to failure? Failure. I'm a failure. A cock-a-doodle-doo, a rooster, would remind you of your worst failure in life. And it happens every day. It happened to Peter that way. Yeah, it happened to Peter, Jesus' disciple. Peter, he was the disciple who thought, man, they're the disciples and he's the disciple of the disciple. He's like top-notch disciple. He's like leader of the other disciples. He's in Jesus' inner three. When all the other disciples wanted to ask Jesus a question, they would say, hey, Peter, ask him for us. Peter thought of himself as, even at one point goes, you know what, if they all leave you, I'm still here, I'm your guy. But there was that time, you see, that Peter was telling Jesus, if they all leave you, I'm still here, that Jesus says, really, Peter? Because here's the deal, when things really go bad, before the rooster cock-a-doodles, you will have denied me three times. You would have failed me three times, Peter. And he was right. How could he have even known that? But he was right. Each time, do you know? I don't know who that guy is. I don't know. And then the rooster crows, and now it's like a curse that every single time the rooster crows in the morning, he's simply reminded of that failure. I wonder what reminds you of your failure. Maybe it's not a rooster, but maybe it's the sight of that person. And every time you see that one particular person, you're reminded of that terrible failure in your life. Or maybe it's a note that you get, or maybe it's a message that's sent, or maybe it's a phone call, or when it pops up and that caller ID is there and you're reminded of that failure. I don't know what it is in your life, but I do know this. All of us have failures. And all of us get reminded of those failures on a regular basis. And how does that make you feel? How do you function? How do you live day in and day out with the reminders? What does it do? Has it sidelined you? Has it caused you to say, maybe I am that failure. Maybe there's no hope for somebody like me. You see, in our text, that has been our text in this entire series, it's found in Matthew chapter 5:13. Let me read it to you again. Jesus said this, and he's saying it to his disciples. He says, guys, listen up. You are the salt of the earth. But what good is salt if it has lost its flavor? You guys know this one. You've been here for the past 3 weeks. He says, can you make it salty again? Now, it will be good, or it will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as, and now I want you to do this. I want you to circle this last word, worthless. Worthless. And certainly, every time that rooster crows and Peter remembers his failure, he probably remembers the message that Jesus spoke to him and the other disciples when he said, you're the salt of the earth, but hey, you know what? If you lose your saltiness, you're worthless. And maybe in his mind, Peter would have circled that word and said, he was talking about me. I certainly lost my saltiness because I denied him, and now I guess I'm just worthless. I'm a throwaway. I'm somebody who has no meaning and no purpose, and what do I have now? I've got nothing in life. I guess maybe the only thing left for me to do, because he certainly wouldn't want me, is to go back and go fishing. I'll just go fishing. I'll go back to what I was before he found me. And so many of us live in that zone, and we live in that place of, I've got this failure, and I've got this failure, and I've got this failure, and I might as well just kind of go hide until I die because I'm nothing. But then we see something happen. But then we see something that Jesus does. But then we see that he doesn't leave Peter in that place. In that place of worthlessness, in that place. No. We see something incredible, something amazing, something wonderful. You see, Peter had seen Jesus die, and he saw the empty tomb. He realized he was alive. He himself said, but he certainly wouldn't want to see somebody like me again after I let him down like that. But what then do we find Jesus doing? And that's where we come to this text in John 21, the very end of the book of John. Simon Peter said, I'm going fishing. And the other disciples, a few of them were there. They said, you know what? We'll come too. So they went out in the boat, but they caught nothing all night. At dawn, now do me a favor and just circle those two words, at dawn, because we're going to bring that back up in just a minute. And I think it will have some significance for each one of us. At dawn, Jesus was standing on the beach, but the disciples couldn't see who he was. And he called out, fellows, have you caught any fish? No, they replied. Then he said, throw out your net on the right-hand side of the boat and you'll get some. Now let me stop right there, because if you go to the book of Luke chapter 5, you see a whole other account of something very, very similar to this happening. In fact, Jesus in Luke chapter 5, he comes to the edge of the shore because all these people are pressing in wanting to hear him speak and talk. And there's so many that he steps into this boat that was right there and asks the guys who own the boat to kind of push out a little bit so he has some room. And he speaks. And then after he speaks, he says, hey, push out a little bit further. Let's do some fishing. You want to do some fishing? And these are fishermen, and they go out a little bit further, Peter being one of those. And he says, hey, you're not catching anything on this side of the boat. Why don't you cast it over on this side of the boat. And these fishermen obviously are like, this guy, yeah, he might be a good teacher, but he is not a good fisherman. He doesn't know how it works. And they toss it in on the other side and they catch all these fish. And when they do, Peter looks at him and says, get away from me. Just get away from me because I'm no good. I'm no good. You shouldn't be around somebody like me. And I bet, as they're listening to this guy who they don't know who it is, standing on about 100 yards away on the seashore, calling out, doing the same thing. Hey, you haven't caught anything? Then throw it on the other side. Suddenly going, uh-oh, this is really familiar sounding. Throw out your net on the right-hand side of the boat and you'll get some. So they did, and they couldn't haul in the net because there were so many fish in it. Then the disciple Jesus loved. Hey, do me a favor and circle that phrase, the disciple Jesus loved, okay? We're going to look at that a little bit later too. Then the disciple Jesus loved said to Peter, it's the Lord. It's the Lord, Peter. Hey, don't you remember? Hey, listen, it's the Lord. That's got to be who that is. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his tunic, for he had stripped for work. He jumped. Don't you love that? Don't you love that? He doesn't have his robe. He doesn't have his tunic on, and he had stripped for fishing. And now you put. Don't you usually take more off when you jump in the water? But he puts his tunic on, and he jumps out into the water and headed to shore. In other words, I can't wait for this slow boat to get back to the shore. It's too slow. I got to get there quicker. So he jumped into the water and headed ashore. The others stayed with the boat and pulled the loaded net to the shore, for they were only about 100 yards from shore. When they got there, they found breakfast waiting for them, fish cooking over a charcoal fire and some bread. Bring some of the fish you just caught, Jesus said. So Simon Peter went aboard and dragged the net to shore. There were 153 large fish, and yet the net hadn't torn. Now come and have some breakfast, Jesus said. None of the disciples dared to ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Then Jesus served them the bread and the fish. What just happened? What just happened? In that moment, what just happened? What just happened is what can happen to you and I. What can happen to you and I after our failures, if we let him. What do I do when I fail? What do I do when I fail? Real quick, how many of you watch some basketball? Anybody watch basketball? How many of you watch the Hawks? You watch the Hawks? How many of you like to watch Trae Young? Trae Young? How many of you don't like sports at all? I can tell. No. Some of us, you know, watch a little basketball, watch Trae Young. Oh, he's fun to watch. Hawks did actually pretty good the last couple seasons. Going to be even better this year. But I'm saying that because Falcons aren't, okay? No, that's my hope. I'll leave that alone, sorry. But there's something in basketball called the rebound. How many of you know what the rebound is? Yeah, the rebound is when you take a shot and you fail. It doesn't go in the basket. Instead, it bounces off. And you run back and get it again and take another shot. No good NBA player is ever going to take a shot, miss the basket, and say, that's it, my career's over, I'm done. I missed the shot. No, a good player knows you got to rebound and rebound and rebound and keep going and keep going. How is it that you can rebound after your failures? Are you rebounding? Or have some of you taken a shot and said, well, I guess that's it for me. I'm no good. I'm worthless. I'm out of the game. Or can you find that rebound? And I think what we see here is the rebound that we're talking about. The rebound that puts us back into that place where God is able to use us. I'm going to give you four things real quick this morning. I'm not going to keep you long. But I think the first thing we learn from this is exactly what Peter did. And I want you to write it down. Number one, what to do when I fail? Run to God, not from God. Run to God, not from God. Now, here's the deal. When I say not from God, that actually is instinctually our first move. That's what most of us, that's what we feel like we should do, is run from God, which is kind of a funny thing, because David felt like after he sinned, he needed to run from God. But he says, where can I go to escape your presence? Where can I go? If I go here, you're there. If I go there, you're there. I can't get away from you. And he's right about that. But instinctually, we were like, oh, I just got to. It's the same thing as Peter. When he sees Jesus that first time, and they get all these fish, and he realizes who he's standing in the presence of, he knows that, whew, I can't even stand in your presence. I shouldn't be in your presence. And he says, get away from me, Jesus. Get away from me, man. Whoever you are, because I'm a sinner, I'm a mess, and I just can't be here. And many of us, when we fail, we feel exactly like that, and we don't want to run to God, but we want to run from God. Many of us will check out of church. I was at church, but then I failed, so I guess church is not the place for me. I'm not going to church. Many of us are like, man, I was in a small group. Now I'm not going to be in this group because, well, there are people in that group that I can't be around because I failed. And they're celebrate recovery. And I was in Celebrate Recovery because of my failures, but now I failed. Now I guess I can't go to Celebrate Recovery. And it's just the opposite is true. But we have that tendency to run from God rather than to his presence. But Peter puts on his tunic and jumps into the water and says, now it's different. I can't get there quick enough. I can't get there quick enough because I know back there is no life, but up there is life on the beach where he's at. And I've got to run to him. How about you? What do you do? Do you run from? Were you checked in? Were you a part? But then something happened, and now you don't feel like you can be a part, and now you're not anymore? I got to tell you guys, how many of you like to go grocery shopping? Do you like grocery shopping? I actually like grocery shopping. Is that weird? And Kim, she does not like grocery shopping. And so we've got this kind of deal worked out where, hey, yeah, I'll go to the grocery store. I kind of like it. And she's like, have at it. And she go to the grocery store. And so I'll go to the grocery store with a grocery list. And I'll go in. I'll get my buggy. And I'll start going up and down the aisles and so forth. And every once in a while, it happens actually quite often, that I'll spot somebody, a member of Community Bible Church, at the grocery store. Maybe a member that I haven't seen in a while. And what happens is I'll see that person see me, but not know that I saw them, and they think that I didn't see them when I saw them see me. You follow that? Yeah. And so I see them see me, but not think I saw them see me. And so they begin to act like they didn't see me. And they do what I call the grocery store duck, you know? I'm in the meat section, here they go up the cereal aisle. And so that's my cue then, where I begin to chase them, you know? Oh yeah, you're gonna act like you didn't see me? Here I come. I'm coming after you, baby. And I'll round the corner at just the right time, and I catch them, and they're like, Pastor Bo, oh, so good to see you. And then comes the confessional time. And what I mean by that is I don't have to say anything. I'm like, oh, good to see you. And they're like, well, you know, you probably realize that I haven't been at church in a while. And I'm like, really, where you been? And well, Pastor, you know, we got this thing, you know. And here's the thing. I feel like saying, God, you don't have to confess to me, okay? I'm nobody. Don't worry about me. But why is it that you would check out away from him? Why would you? We got to run to him. We got to see our need for him, that there's no life without him, and run to him. Unto him, not away from God. Hey, Satan has a strategy. I believe his strategy is this. He minimizes sin before we sin, but then maximizes failure after we sin. You see what happened? In other words, he'll come to us and he'll make whatever it is, hey, this is no big deal. It's really no big deal. It's just small. It's nothing. Everybody's doing it. It's not that bad. It's okay. No problem. Don't worry about that. No big, and minimizes. But then after we fail, suddenly he maximizes it and says, wow, you are the worst person. I can't believe you did that. How awful that is, and nobody in church is ever going to want to see you again. God doesn't want to hear from you again after this. I mean, you've already asked for forgiveness once. Why would he forgive you again? God's up there going, are you again? He doesn't want to see, and he maximizes our failures. And the whole purpose is to keep us from pressing closer, keep us from God. But what if, like Peter, we turn the tables? And when we fail, we start running. We can't get there quick enough. We jump in the water. We've got to go as fast as we can to get back to him. When I fail, I've got to get back to church. When I fail, I've got to get back to my group where they'll encourage me and challenge me and speak life into me. When I fail, I've got to get back to Celebrate Recovery where I can open up about my failure and I can tell people, I've got to get back. What if, because you know what would happen then? If that happened every time, then Satan would catch on pretty quick and be like, ooh, I see what's going on here. I see what's going on here. I'm simply pushing them back into this relationship with God. Yeah, that's what he does. He maximizes our sin and minimizes our sin and then maximizes our failure. But what if that could be flipped? Run to God, not from God. Number two, what to do when I fail? Refuse to let my failures define me. Refuse to let my failures define me. Hey, listen. I think I would like to report some of you in here for emotional abuse of yourself. I would like to report some of you in here for emotional abuse of yourself. In other words, the things you say about yourself in your mind, the things you call yourself, the things you tell yourself, the lies you speak to yourself on a regular basis. I was walking in the woods just yesterday, and as I'm walking down this path, I hear some people coming the opposite direction, and it sounds like they're a little loud, like kids, and they get a little bit closer, and I see two brothers who they looked absolutely identical. One's a little bit bigger than the other, a little bit older than the other, and they're about 100 feet or so in front of their, who I guess was probably their mother and their grandmother, who are following up behind. And so here they are, and they're coming past me, and they're loud, and they're saying stuff back and forth to each other. And what I realize is each one's trying to get in front of the other to lead, you know? And they're kind of pushing their way. And finally, the older brother, when the younger brother steps in front of him, he goes, "You're just a dummy." And that's when I hear the grandmother yell out, "Stop calling each other names." And the one boy yells back, "I'm not calling him a name." And grandmother says, "Dummy is a name." But I wonder how many of us just this last week said, "Oh, to myself, you're such a dummy. Oh, you're such an idiot. Oh, you're such a loser. You're such a fool. You're so worthless." You know, Scripture tells us, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. We might think our words that we say to ourselves are harmless, like sticks and stones may break our bones, but words will never harm me. But the truth is, they do. There's power in our words, and there's power in the words that we even say to ourselves. And when we say something, get this, when we say something about ourselves to ourselves that's opposite of what God says about us, then that's a lie that we're telling ourselves. And Scripture tells us that lies come from Satan himself. And so, in other words, my identity is being shaped on a regular basis by the lies I'm believing from Satan himself to me. And I just repeat them over and over and over. And I'm emotionally abusing myself. Let's look at it this way. Suppose somebody in here is like, oh, you know what? I'd love to get some pastoral counseling from Pastor Bo. And guys, I've said this over and over. I am not a good counselor. If I need a counselor, I'm not going to go see myself, okay? But you go, I want to talk with Pastor Bo and get some pastoral counseling. And so you set up an appointment. You come to my office. You sit down. And we sit down in there together. And I say, all right, tell me what's going on with you. And you start to tell me. And I'm like, oh, well, that was stupid. Boy, you are a dummy. You know what? Not just that. You're the worst person I've ever met. I can't believe you're even sitting in my office. There is no help for you at all. Suppose that's my counseling. You'd probably get up and get mad and get offended and be like, how dare he say that to me? And you'd be right. You'd be right. So why do you take it from yourself? Why are you taking it from yourself instead of hearing his idea of you? His identity of you, what he says about you. You look what it says right here in John 21:15. After breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, Peter replied, you know I love you. Let's go back to that. Simon, son of John. What does that mean? It's in English should be Simon, John's son, son of John. Some of your Bibles say son of Jonah, Jonas, all the same thing. Simon, son of John, Simon Johnson. Why is he saying Simon Johnson when before he's already named him Peter? You know what's going on right here? Every time you see him, Jesus saying Simon, son of John, you know it's a dramatic moment that is taking place. It's not just, it's an intimate moment. It's a let me get your attention kind of moment. It's Peter, look into my eyes and listen to me. Peter, Simon, son of John. It's kind of like, remember when you used to get in trouble and your mom would call you by your full name? Simon, son of John. Simon Johnson. Listen to me. This is important. Do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Then feed my lambs. In other words, Simon, son of John, I know what you think about yourself, and I know you think you're a failure. But Simon, son of John, even though you think you're a failure, I need you to feed my lambs. In other words, I'm putting you in that leadership position that I had you in before, even though you failed. Simon, son of John, I'm not defining you by your failures. Simon, son of John, listen, those failures don't make up you. Quit listening to the lies, Simon, son of John. Listen to me, what I'm telling you here, now. Feed my lambs. And maybe that's when Peter thinks back to that moment, that time where Jesus looks at him and renames him, gives him another name, a new name, the name of Peter or Petros or the rock. Let me read it to you. Matthew 16:18. Now I say to you that you are Peter, which means rock. And upon this rock, I will build my church, and all the powers of hell will not conquer it. And he's going, Peter, he called me rock, and I thought I was rock, but I failed him. I'm not rock, I'm more like shattered glass. I didn't handle the pressure. I didn't stand up on it. I failed. But he says, no, Simon, son of John, I'm putting you back at that place. You're going to be the rock. You're going to be the rock, my rock. I call you rock for a purpose. And I'm going to build my church on it. Wouldn't you like to be called the Rock? That's a good name, isn't it? Not only that. He was fishing with the brothers of Zebedee. Remember them, James and John? Do you know that he actually started calling them the brothers or the sons of thunder? That's a cool name too, right? So we got the Rock and we got thunder. And then I had you underline a little bit earlier. The guy writing what we're reading right here is John, obviously, book of John. But John refers to himself in this story as, oh yeah, you're the rock and y'all are the sons of thunder, but me, I'm the one he loves. Ha! How about that? Wouldn't you like to be called, I'm the one he loves? Why am I saying all this, guys? Because what if tomorrow morning, when the cock crows, when you get up, that instead of saying, oh, the loser's awake, the dummy just got up, the worthless got out of bed, why don't you get up and say, the one he loves just got up. Hey, your rock just got out of bed, Jesus. Your thunder. We just sang a song. I'm a child of love. Child of love. Why don't you say that? Why don't you take that name instead and believe the truths that he says. Don't let your failures define you. Instead, let him say who it is that you really are. Repeat it to yourself. Say it to yourself. Believe it. And then number three, run to God, not from God is the first one. Refuse to let my failures define me is the second one. Number three, recycle the pain from my failures. I'm to recycle the pain from my failures. When I say the pain, first of all, let me read this scripture to you, John 21:17. A third time, he asked him three times total, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. In parentheses, he's just putting there, he put salt in the wound, right? He didn't have to ask him three times, but on that third time, that was just like, he's rubbing it in now, salt in the wound. But what does salt in a wound do? It heals. When I was a kid, my mom, when I'd scrape my knee after falling off a bicycle and be all bloody and everything, I'd go in, put me in the bathroom, and she'd pull out something called methylate. Yeah. All of you who have had methylate, you know what I'm talking. How many of you had thought, oh, that was just cruelty, right? She'd pull out methylate, and nothing would burn like methylate, but she'd rub that methylate on there. It would start to burn. It'd start to sting, and there's mom going, Mom, it's not helping. This burns. But she would say, no, but the burn means it's working. The burn means it's healing. The sting. And it's that pain that we feel over the failure that God can use to bring about healing and helping others around you. It's that recycling of your pain from your failures. Whenever I go to the airport, and that's where I think of it, but I'm in the concourse there, and maybe I've bought a bottle of water, finish the water, and then I'll go to throw the bottle away, and the bins have three big openings, and one you throw it in here for plastics, one you throw it in here for, I think, like glass, and the other is just garbage. And you have a choice every time you go up to that bin, do you not? Do I throw it the plastic in the plastic, or do I throw it in the garbage and just forget about it and it goes to the dump? And each and every time, when we're reminded of that failure, what do we do with that? I can trash myself and I can say I'm worthless, I'm a throwaway, or I can take the pain and put it in the place where it can be used by God, recycled for that which is good. In fact, here's the deal. Everybody look up to the ceiling. Look up to the ceiling. I want you to imagine a big hole right there. And on the top of that hole, looking down, is a big word that says recycle. And can you imagine? You see what each one of you, you know what? You're a water bottle that got dumped in here. And that God is going to take and use in a way you never dreamed or thought possible. And maybe somebody's new here to church today, and they just got dumped in here for the first time. And you can look at them because you've been here and you've seen how God has been changing you and working through you in your life. In fact, look at the person next to you and say, God's not finished with you yet. Instead, he's going to do work through you. He's going to do work through you if you let him recycle the pain that you have experienced from your failure in life. Hey, I want to bring somebody up here on stage with me this morning. His name is Mike. Mike, come on up here. Mike has an incredible ministry that God is using him with. It's called Broken Chains. Give Mike a big hand as he comes up here and let him know how much you appreciate him. And Mike, I'd love for you to share just a minute, a little bit of your story and how God is working through you right now.
Well, this whole sermon is about me. Useless. But God has shown me a little bit different here.
Amen.
Well, I'll tell you real quick a little bit about me. And first of all, I'm a very grateful believer in Jesus Christ today. And, you know, I it hasn't always been that way, though. But I'm in recovery. I'm in recovery for 40 years of heroin and meth addiction. But, you know, I'm celebrating 16 years clean today. And thank you. And it's all him, man. Well, I'll tell you how I got that way. Like a lot of young kids these days, I got in with the wrong crowd when I was 13 years old, you know. I was just talking to a little girl out in the atrium a minute ago, and she was telling us, you know, she was 13, talking about how they're doing so many drugs in school now, just, you know, right there. And I said, yeah, I remember that. Well, I was 13 years old when I became a heroin addict, an IV heroin addict, at 13 years old. And that first day was the end of my childhood, as I knew it. And it was the beginning of a new life of pure hell that I stayed chained to for the next 40 years. During that time, I OD'd so many times, I couldn't even tell you how many. I had to be rushed to the hospital and brought back to life. And I was in head-on collisions from being so messed up. You know, I hit a car head-on on a motorcycle one time, 60 miles an hour, no helmet on. I shouldn't live through any of it, you know. But God had a different plan. And, you know, I spent 20 years in a motorcycle gang, an outlaw motorcycle gang. And I don't have to even tell you some of the bad things that happened in my life during that time. I was a dope dealer. And I became the biggest addict that you've ever seen. I burned up all my bridges, though, in 2005, in December 2005, I found myself at the end of my rope, looking down the barrel of a .44 Magnum, because I just didn't want to live anymore. I remembered the day that my dad told me when he picked me up out of jail that, son, you're never going to amount to anything. And you know what? He was right. I was 52 years old, man, and I hadn't done anything good in my life. I didn't want to live anymore. I just wanted to get out of it. But God had a different plan then, too. Now, I don't know how, but somehow he took that gun out of my hand, and the next thing I know, by a series of events that could have only been orchestrated by God himself, I found myself turning into the driveway of all things. Now, listen, I'm coming off the streets, being in a motorcycle gang for 20 years, okay? I'm pretty rough life. I'm turning into the driveway of a Christian rehab center up in the mountains of North Carolina called Christian Love Ministries. Don't know how I got there, but when I saw that sign, I thought to myself, man, you are messed up. Well, you sure don't belong here. Because that was not my lifestyle, but that was God's plan. And a few days later, on Christmas Day in 2005, I went to a little church in Hayesville, North Carolina. It was a Free Will Baptist church. Now, I didn't know what that was, but it didn't sound too good to me. But I went in there, and this old preacher, he was coming out, a young guy. He was just a hoot and holler and carrying on. I'm like, I'm too smart to hear all that, you know. But then the Holy Spirit got a hold of me. I found myself on my knees down at the altar crying like a baby. and I met Jesus that day. And man, did he ever change my life for the good. Yeah, he did. So I came back home and I started this program called Celebrate Recovery. Now, Jesus saved my life, and I know that today. But he used this ministry called Celebrate Recovery to help me survive, to help me to get through, to help me to get to the point that I am today. Today, I get to serve as a state rep for Celebrate Recovery. I go around and help people in other churches start Celebrate Recoveries at their church. He's also using me in prison. I go to prison every Wednesday, and I minister to the guys in there. I take Celebrate Recovery inside to the prisons and minister to them. Because they listened to me because I was there once. I was where they are. God's used me amazingly. I get to serve as the national director for the Eastern United States for a ministry called Broken Chains, which is, it's just Celebrate Recovery in the wind. We're the biker arm of Celebrate Recovery. And he's just using me like crazy. And I just owe it all to this, to him, for his saving me in the first place, but for the ministry of Celebrate Recovery that we have right here at this church. Now you're thinking, well, I'm not one of those people. I don't need that stuff. But you know what? Those drugs were just a surface issue of some much deeper lying root causes, and that's what I found out at Celebrate Recovery. Like the hurt, the trust issues and all that came from all the stuff that happened to me in my childhood, you know, those things had never been dealt with. But Celebrate Recovery helped me to bring those things out to where we could work on them and find the healing that I finally needed to get to where I am now. So if you're in here today, and how many of you in here might have some hurts, hang-ups, or habits in your life? Well, the rest of you are in denial. And as they say, that's not a river in Egypt. But no, Celebrate Recovery is for everyone. If you've got anything in your life that's holding you back from being all that God wants you to be, then Celebrate Recovery. It's where you need to be. Amen. So y'all come out and visit us, man, and see just what we're all about. And, you know, God did that for me. If he did that for me, he can do it for anyone, you know. So the other thing I wanted to share with you is, you know, I 5 years ago I found out because of all those bad choices that I made all my life or all the abuse that I did in my body, for the IV use that I did when I was young, I found out I had cirrhosis and stage 4 liver cancer. And at first they said, well, there's nothing we can do for you. It's gotten too bad. Tumors are too big. We can't. But then they tried this procedure and it shrank the tumors down. And well, a year later, I was in there getting a liver transplant. And today, 5 years now, I'm clean. I mean, I'm still here, and God's still using me. So, yeah, that's all God.
And you got a grandbaby.
And he's restored the relationships with my kids that I had lost, and I just had a great grandbaby born this week. So God is restoring the years that the locusts have eaten. Right?
Amen.
So thank you all for letting me share. Y'all come out and see us at Celebrate Recovery.
Oh, thanks, buddy. Appreciate it. Glad to meet you. Here's something that's kind of cool is, in addition to that, I had no idea Mike was going to be out there today in the atrium psalm this morning, and it was as if God said, hey, you shut up for a while and let Mike talk. But I strongly believe that that is the message that somebody, especially in particular, needed to hear today. And so we're praying for that healing, for that you in particular who I'm talking to. Finally, number four, relax in God's grace. Relax in God's grace. What happens here? He restores Peter. And Peter has to realize that the grace that has been shown to him, Jesus now says, go feed my sheep, is the grace that goes to others. If you relax and enjoy it, rest in it. I don't know, how many of you are people who, my wife tells me all the time, can't you just relax? Anybody like that? Can't you? And I was like, I can't. I went to the, it's tough for me. I'm one of those people who it's, you know, don't just stand there, do something, right? Anybody like that? And I think oftentimes God says, don't just do something, but you need to stand there. And you need to experience the goodness and the grace of your God. I was at the doctor two days ago. They're checking my blood pressure. And the tech who walked in and was taking my blood pressure, she took it and, you know, they put that cuff on and then she looks at me, she goes, wow, your blood pressure is high. And I said, yeah, I guess that's kind of why I'm here, you know. And she goes, well, let's do this. And she goes, you just relax. And she started talking to me like that, just relax. And she goes, I'm going to do some stuff over here, and then I'm going to come back, and I'm going to take your blood pressure, and we're going to see what it is then. And so she takes a little minute, and she walks back over, puts the cuff back on, and she goes, now, I want you to think of the beach. How many beach people? Got beach people? Oh, yeah. And so I went there. I went there in my mind. I went to the beach. Just started thinking about the beach. And, you know, it went down 30 points after she said that. And I thought, how cool is that? That she said, think of this. Focus on this. And now, I want to do the same thing to you this morning, but I don't want you to think of the beach. I want you to think of God's grace. I want you to focus on God's grace and how good he is. Do you know there's absolutely nothing you could do that can make God love you any more or any less than he does right now? And he says, rest in that grace. Rest in the grace and watch how he's able to take you and use you. Here's the deal. I had you circle on the scripture two words at the very beginning of the message, and the two words were at dawn. At dawn. Why is that important? Well, when does the rooster crow? And so in this moment, what we see is every time Peter had heard cock-a-doodle-doo, he thought of failure. Now every time he hears cock-a-doodle-doo, he thinks of the amazing grace of God. And so that is what he wants each one of us to do. Rest in that grace. Know that you have been restored. And your failures are not final. Let's bow in a word of prayer. Friend, if you don't know Jesus like that, like we talked about this morning, his goodness and in grace, his grace, I pray that you would call out to him here in this moment. You might have thought before that salvation comes by your performance, and if you do good, then maybe you can get there. But it absolutely does not. It comes only by God's amazing grace. That begins a relationship with God that will never, ever end, your Heavenly Father. So if you've never asked Jesus Christ into your heart for the forgiveness of sin, please, here now, do that in this moment. Just call out to him and say, Jesus, come into my life and forgive me. Forgive me of my sin and be my God and my Savior and my best friend forever and ever. And friend, when you pray that prayer and you mean it with your heart, the Bible says you can know that you have eternal life. You're a child of God, and you can never be separated from him. So say, thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. And Father, we rejoice in those who just prayed that and made that decision. Father, we rejoice in the fact that our failures are not final, and you restore us by your amazing grace. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yeah,
thanks, buddy.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, man.
Yeah. New sermon series coming up next Sunday, the Adulting Sermon Series. So.
What could that be about?
What could that be about? We're all going to have to act mature next week. New groups, though, also coming with this series, Pastor.
Yeah, a lot of new groups launching next week. We have one for if you're a parent of teens, okay, young children, if you're a grandparent, want to be in a group. We also have groups that will be specific to the sermon series that Pastor Bo is teaching. Also got some
men's groups.
A men's group, right? Got a men's fellowship group and a women's fellowship group at 9:30 to show up.
A men's group. Do you think? Can we talk sports in there? Can we talk sports in the men's group?
You can talk sports probably in the men's group as long as you pray. I think you really just want to show off your Falcon pair of shoes. That's all you want to do.
Yeah, because I like to brag on the Falcons for sure. Yeah. Anyway.
A lot of great groups that will launch next week. Go by the connection table on your way out. Pastor Butch and Ms. Paul will be there. And I would love to get you signed up so that you can have some fellowship with some people.
Hey, this is cool. This is cool. We've got these door hangers that have been made. Now, here's something that I want to ask you to do, if you'd be so willing, is take one Wednesday night out of the month of October. Here's what we're going to do. We feel that we really want to touch around the neighborhoods just around the church with a little bit of love. And we don't want to bother them. We don't want to intrude. We don't want to bang on their door. But we do have a door hanger. And what we're going to do is one Wednesday night and you can just write on your card, count me in on Wednesday night, group, whatever. We'll get in touch with you. But one Wednesday night, if you'd go with a group to a neighborhood with us, and we're going to stand in front of house after house after house and just say a quick prayer for the people in that home. We'll leave this on their door. It simply says, we prayed for you today, and if there's any other way community can love on you, just let us know with contact information, just to love on the people in the neighborhoods right close around the church. So help us out with that. Sign up for that on a Wednesday night if you would, okay? That'd be awesome. Just write it on your card. And then also, I brought this up here. I don't even know if we have enough. There should be some still out there, maybe so. I hope so. This is a really cool mug. If you would like to, if you know a friend, a neighbor, a coworker, somebody that you can would like to just give a free mug to that has an invite to our online ministry, you can go give this to them and just be something like, hey, this is the church I go to. Y'all check it out sometime. But it's a cool mug. Do not keep it for yourself, all right? Do not. We don't. Bunch of thieves in here. Bunch of thieves. Now, go grab one. Go grab one out there on the table and use it to invite somebody, okay?
Yeah, great invite tool. And then one final announcement. Mike, who gave that amazing testimony a few minutes ago, mentioned he's part of Celebrate Recovery. We have Celebrate Recovery here every Thursday. And Celebrate Recovery is doing a 5K. And next week, I believe, is the last day you can sign up for this 5K. So you'll want to get involved in that.
It's a virtual 5K.
It's a virtual 5K. So we're giving away virtual trophies.
You get a real t-shirt. You really
I'm going to virtually run laps around you guys. You watch it, man.
Yeah, I'm going to virtually run a full marathon.
I'm just wearing 5K. You can run a marathon if you want.
So if you virtually want to be a part of that, you can sign up for it. Today,
can I add one more thing to that?
Yes.
On the 29th, we're celebrating 15 years of Celebrating Recovery. Yeah. So come out Thursday night and join the party with us and celebrate 15 years.
Love it. Love
That's
it.
That's it. We're going to take the offering.
All right. You guys ready to take the offering?
Yeah.
Let's do it. Father, thank you so much as we give to you. We're blessed by you, Father. May we bless you in return, not just by our words, but by our actions. Father, take what we give. Use it for your honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll be right back.
great job, guys. Hey, thanks again for being here. By the way, if you're new to Community